front-end engineering. It's the creative side of coding that brings websites and apps to life, focusing on user experience, interface design, and making things visually appealing. It's a lot more than just centering divs and creating buttons, though. That's why in this video, I'm going to walk you through this clear-cut guide to everything you actually need to know to get hired as a front-end engineer. Feel free to skip over sections you already know by clicking the timestamps linked in the description. Also, if you're more interested in back-end engineering, check out last week's back-end engineering roadmap. Front-end engineering builds the interface that users interact with for any software. Let's use YouTube as a simple example. When you open YouTube, the front-end engineering work is everything you can see. The layout of the page, the rendering of the graphics, and the animation of the subscribe button are all things that front-end engineers design. Front-end engineering is incredibly complex. A common misconception is that front-end engineering is easier than back-end engineering. This is definitely not true, and front-end engineering has many interesting and complicated challenges. One challenge is responsive design. YouTube can be run on many different platforms, from phones to computers to even TVs. Front-end engineers need to ensure that the software is responsive to the device it is being used on. Another challenge is state management. When you pause a video on YouTube, you can come back to it later, and it will pick up right where you left off. Managing one video for one single user may seem trivial, but managing multiple videos for billions of different users is very complex. Ultimately, if you're someone who's more visually driven and enjoys creating the things that users interact with, then front-end engineering is definitely something for you. If you've never coded before, or have no front-end coding experience, you'll need to start by learning the fundamentals. Unlike back-end engineering, where there are tons of choices, front-end engineering has three specific coding languages you need to know, which are HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. And before anyone comments it, yes, I know that technically HTML and CSS aren't coding languages, but come on, everyone calls them coding languages. The first language you need to learn is HTML. HTML forms the structure of web pages by defining elements such as headings, paragraphs, lists, images, and more. Understanding HTML semantics, tags, and document structure is fundamental for creating accessible and well-structured content. The second language you need to know is CSS. CSS is used for styling and layout, transforming HTML elements into visually appealing components. Knowing how to work in CSS is critical for creating responsive designs and consistent user interfaces across devices. And last, but definitely not least, is JavaScript. JavaScript adds interactivity and dynamic behavior to web pages. This is where common coding concepts, such as variables, data types, functions, loops, and more, are all used to create interactive user interfaces and responsive web applications. These three languages work together to make up the front end. Using a house analogy makes this easy to understand. HTML is like your structure of the house, CSS is like the interior design, and JavaScript is like the smart home devices that control temperature, lighting, and more. Mastering HTML for structure, CSS for styling, and JavaScript for interactivity allows front-end engineers to bring designs to life and engage users effectively. All of this may feel overwhelming and like a lot is being thrown at you all at once. Fortunately, Course Careers, the sponsor of this video, offers a 100% free coding fundamentals course that you can take to learn the basics of coding. On top of this, they also offer a complete front-end engineering course that teaches you absolutely everything you need to know about front-end engineering. No matter your skill level, you can use these courses. In fact, they just had a carpenter become a full-time engineer in only 4 months. Start the Coding Fundamentals course today for free using the link in the description below. And if you use this link, you'll get a discount of $50 if you decide to purchase the front-end engineering course. Now that we've touched on the coding fundamentals, let's start diving into some of the challenges front-end engineers solve daily. Responsive design is a common front-end engineering task, and is the art of creating web pages that adapt and respond gracefully to different screen sizes and devices. What makes design responsive, though? One tactic is to use something like percentage-based widths and flexible grid systems to create a structure that will adapt to various different screen sizes. For example, if we want a title to take up half of our screen, rather than hard coding a width value like 700 pixels, we can set the width to 50%, meaning it will take up 50% of any screen it is shown on. Another tactic is using media queries, which apply specific styles based on device characteristics such as screen width, resolution, and orientation. Man, writing all this CSS sure sounds tedious, doesn't it? Luckily, we have something called CSS frameworks. CSS frameworks are pre-written CSS style sheets that provide a collection of reusable components, grids, and styles to streamline the development of responsive web interfaces. Popular CSS frameworks include Bootstrap, Foundation, and Tailwind CSS. These frameworks offer things like grid systems, responsive utilities, and component libraries that contain pre-styled components that can be customized and used to build consistent and responsive UI elements. By incorporating responsive design principles and leveraging CSS frameworks, front-end engineers create visually appealing, user-friendly, and adaptive web interfaces that deliver a consistent experience across a wide range of devices and screen resolutions. Not to be confused with CSS frameworks, JavaScript frameworks are JavaScript-based collections of components, modules, and utilities that focus on specific tasks or functionalities within web development. These libraries simplify common tasks, improve code organization, and promote code reusability, something you will really appreciate when you're writing thousands of lines of code. The most popular front-end frameworks are React, Vue, and Angular, but to be honest, there are so many that it can kind of become hard to keep track. Just like how CSS frameworks provide reusable UI, JavaScript frameworks provide reusable functionality for things you build. Think of the subscribe button on YouTube. While CSS frameworks may allow you to create the design of the subscribe button, it doesn't actually do anything until it is hooked up to JavaScript. In a JavaScript framework like React, for example, you could create a subscribe button as a working component that you can reuse anywhere on the website, rather than having to recreate the functionality every time. JavaScript frameworks handle far more than just reusable components, though. They also handle complex things like routing and navigation, state management, form validation, and even more. Trust me, you'll be thankful that you don't have to do these things from scratch. Each JavaScript framework could have hundreds of hours of tutorials, so it's hard to dive in depth to any of them in this video. My recommendation is that if you're at this stage of learning, you should just pick one of the main three frameworks and become very familiar with it. My personal choice is React because it's the most used, which means you'll have the largest bank of online resources if you get stuck or need questions answered. This is definitely the largest learning block for a front-end engineer, so if you're here, don't worry. Learning the ever-changing JavaScript frameworks is a lifelong journey that all front-end engineers constantly have to deal with. Now that we feel confident about building and adding functionality to software pages, we need to allow them to interact with the primary resource on the internet, data. Before you watch this, I recommend going to the backend engineering roadmap from last week and going to around the 3-minute mark to watch the API section. It's only 1 minute long and will provide you a lot of context for working with APIs on the front end. Anyways, on the front end, we display stuff to users. More specifically, we display data to users. When you click on my YouTube channel, you see data like my subscriber count, my videos, and more. The data is handled by the backend and is provided to the frontend through an API, where frontend engineers decide how it should be displayed to users. Let's say you're not subscribed yet. Hit subscribe right now. This isn't just me shamelessly trying to get you to subscribe. It's actually a way for you to see the frontend API integration in action. When you hit subscribe, the frontend detects a user input and makes a call to the backend subscribe API. This API likely includes logic that does things like increase my subscriber count by 1 and add Codebagel to your list of subscribed YouTubers. Your page then automatically updates to show this new change. Now, as you saw, all these updates happened pretty quickly. It may not look like it, but in reality, there are probably hundreds of functions running behind the scene here. So, how do these updates happen so quickly? Writing JavaScript asynchronously is what allows API integration to work quickly and smoothly. JavaScript as a language is what we call single-threaded, meaning it executes one piece of code at a time in a sequential manner. Most of your development experience up until now is with synchronous programming, which is where the code executes sequentially and each operation blocks this thread until it's complete. Asynchronous programming allows JavaScript to perform tasks concurrently without blocking other operations. Technically speaking, JavaScript asynchronous programming isn't exactly concurrent, but for simplicity's sake, we're going to treat it as such for the sake of this video. Here's a simple example. Let's say we have 10 functions, each taking 1 second to run. If we run these synchronously, the total runtime is 10 seconds, as each has to finish before the next function can begin. If we run these asynchronously, the total runtime shortens to 1 second, because all 10 can execute concurrently. Asynchronous JavaScript will level your front-end coding up, and becomes especially useful when you start working with APIs that run hundreds or even thousands of functions at a time. Once you've built a page structure, styled it, added functionality with JavaScript, and integrated with a backend API, you now have a working front-end. But what happens if you go to make changes and suddenly everything breaks? How do you fix this? This is where debugging comes into the picture. Now, similar to backend engineering, you can debug by using log and print statements. But one additional feature of front-end engineering is that you can debug in the browser by using developer tools. One of the major features of developer tools is the ability to edit the DOM. This is a fundamental front-end engineering concept I waited until now to mention because I feel it's easier to comprehend once you have a grasp of the front-end engineering concepts we've just covered. The DOM, or Document Object Model, is a programming interface that represents the structure and content of a web page as a hierarchical tree of objects. It allows JavaScript to access, manipulate, and interact with HTML elements on the web page dynamically, enabling dynamic content updates and interactivity in web applications. Using the DOM is incredibly useful for debugging, as it provides developers a more understandable representation of their web applications. Using developer tools, developers can view the DOM and directly change the HTML, CSS, and JavaScript code in their browser, enabling real-time changes and experimentation with the layout, styling, and behavior of web elements. Developer tools also allow you to monitor the network to track network requests, responses, headers, payloads, and other performance metrics. This helps developers analyze API calls, caching behavior, and identify any network-related bugs. Getting familiar with developer tools will allow you to debug much more effectively, so even though it's a bit boring, this is a must-do. After you've debugged, you need to write reusable tests for your code. For the front-end, there are 3 kinds of tests. Unit testing focuses on testing individual components or functions in isolation. For YouTube, a unit test example could be testing the functionality of a video playback component. Integration testing verifies the interaction and integration between different components within the YouTube application, ensuring seamless functionality across interconnected parts. An integration test could focus on testing the interaction between the video player component and the comment section component. Lastly, end-to-end or E2E testing evaluates the entire flow and functionality of the application from the user's perspective, simulating real user interactions and scenarios. An end-to-end test scenario could involve testing the user journey of searching for a video, playing it, interacting with related videos, and leaving a comment. Writing tests can be really boring because it feels like you're not actually building anything, but it's essential for making sure that your code is maintained long-term and that random changes won't break the entire application you've worked hard on. Truthfully, this roadmap just barely scratches the surface of front-end engineering. Front-end engineering has so many different things to learn that most people spend an entire career picking up new things. So, after you've covered this roadmap, what's next? I definitely recommend learning TypeScript once you've mastered JavaScript. TypeScript is JavaScript, but with static typing, which makes it a very useful upgrade. After this, you have more JavaScript frameworks and libraries to learn, you can explore progressive web app development, learn more about modern CSS techniques, the list goes on and on. This is where the learning gets fun. You get to choose your own adventure. As long as you follow this roadmap and learn the basics, the world of front-end engineering is your oyster. Thanks so much for watching this video. If you like this video and want to see more content like it, make sure you subscribe and hit that notification bell. And if you've decided that front-end engineering isn't for you, check out this video on back-end engineering. See you all in the next video.